slideshow here before on it. I don't know how many of you were here, but what I kind of wanted to do today was talk a little bit about the things and just pretty much open it up for questions and just kind of let your questions guide us and where we need to go today. And rather than me trying to tell you a bunch of stuff that you're not interested in, you ask me what you think you want to know, and if I know, I'll tell you. If I don't, then I'll tell you I don't know. And we'll have to get back with you on that and figure out, you know, what the answer is to your question. But there's a couple of different ways that we can grow plants. And those two ways are we can grow it like we see out in creation, where the Creator has done a system and his system works. Or we can do it in a way that we've been taught by the universities and by the colleges that the industries that are promoting agriculture, that there is a way to do it with a chemical version, and then there's a way to do it with a natural version. And so this is a soil biology is the key to everything that goes on in the world we see around us. So as a farmer or as a gardener or a grower of plants, we can make that choice on one way or the other, because if you choose to go the chemical route where you're using your NPK fertilizers and those kinds of things, they're all salts, and they can grow a plant, and there's no doubt about that. They will grow a plant, and they'll grow it really well. But what is lacking is the minor nutrients, majority of the time in our food and in our plants, that are lacking because of the lack of soil biology. So the way this soil biology works is the plant, we want the plant really to be in control of its own destiny. And because we're, as humans and farmers, we're to the point where almost arrogant that we think that we know what the plant needs, and we can force feed it that, and it's going to respond, and it's going to do what we want it to do. Well, in a natural case, we want that plant to actually be in charge of its own destiny and be able to control the nutrients that it uptakes and how it does that. So the way a plant actually brings nutrients into its system is that it has to have fungi and bacteria and nematodes all present in the soil. That is part of the system. So this plant, if it needs a certain, like just say we were talking about boron earlier today, if this plant needs boron, that plant will put out an exudate, which is a sugar. So basically the plant takes the sugars that is created by photosynthesis through sunlight. It takes those sugars and it puts it down into the roots. And I was always taught that the plant has the sugars and the nutrients come up from the bottom up to the plant and it feeds the leaves and everything. But actually it's the opposite, that 40% of a plant's energy goes into making sugars in the leaves that actually go down into the soil. So this plant is putting these nutrients back down into the soil, these sugars, to feed bacteria and fungi. And then those bacteria and fungi are actually eaten by nematodes. And I know we've always heard that nematodes are a bad thing. There are certain types of nematodes that are detrimental to your plant, but there are also other nematodes that eat those nematodes. So what we're talking about is a quote-unquote soil web system. So basically it starts from the plant is controlling what bacteria and fungi that are around those roots. So these fungi and bacteria are able to process the nutrients that are in the soil. So these nutrients that are in the soil are actually locked up, and it's by design that they're locked up, because if it were like our NPK fertilizers that we have, they're a soluble nutrients. So what's going to happen if it's soluble when water hits it? It's going to leach out of our soil, it's go down into the water system, and it ends up in our lakes and rivers and all these kinds of things. So the plant may get some of it, but it's going to be a lot of it's going to be washed away as leaching from the soil. So this plant puts out these sugars, exudates, and controls this life of biology that's down in the soil. So say if this plant needs boron, it has a certain type of sugar that feeds that microbe that will go out and process boron and bring it to the plant and give it at its optimum time whenever that plant needs it. It may not need it, but one day in its whole life, it may only need boron at one time. But that one time, it needs it critically. So it will send out those exudates down into the soil, and it will make that biology process this nutrient and bring it to it. So it has a symbiotic relationship with these microbes. So these microbes basically are there to help the plant. And then as the plant utilizes the nutrients, it grows off and it feeds other animals in this soil food web, like us. But at these points in time where these plants need these nutrients, they will call in the herd, so to speak, of microbes to do the job. So if your biology is right, the plant can control what's going on with the microbes and it can get the nutrients that it needs. It's my belief that there's enough nutrients in the soil to grow any kind of plant anywhere. And I know when I say that, the people immediately, you know, I get that can't be true, but it is. The only thing that might have happened to that soil is it may have had an event that happened that damaged the soil through human intervention or whatever has happened, a natural event, but the soil has been damaged somewhat, but the soil is always trying to mitigate these damages and trying to remediate itself, and it remediates itself through weeds, basically. That's what it is. The weeds are serving a purpose for that. But this biology happens regardless of what's going on around the plant. It's in control of everything that it needs, and it's in control of these microbes to be able to come in and bring those nutrients to it. Now, on the other hand, if you go with the chemical way to do it, with your normal NPK fertilizers, then you can actually do the same thing, but the plant will not put out these exudates, will not have these microbes in the soil, because they can't exist with these salts in the soil. They can't exist that way. So we're fighting against the system that our Creator put in place. We're fighting against that, and we'll be a lot better off if we will go with Him as opposed to against Him. So we always want to try to do things in the most natural way that we can. And the way, a little background on how we ended up with the NPK fertilizers. You think back, you know, our grandfathers and sometimes maybe our great-grandfathers, they farmed and they grew plants in a different way than what we do today. We've always been taught through our educational system that the way to grow a plant is to put these nutrients to it. But really, in reality, the plant can do it itself, and nowhere in the world is there not enough nutrients in the soil to do what it needs to do to grow this plant. If you have the biology, the key is the biology, because if you don't have the biology, then the plant can't do what it needs to do to have the biology bring the nutrients in that it needs. So therefore, if you get into a loop then, where if you do use a chemical fertilizer then and you damage the bacteria, you're going to have to keep that up. You're going to have to keep that up. And this is the whole paradigm of the, I call it the matrix of going that route of using these chemicals. Back in World War I, after the war, a lot of bombs, a lot of munitions, all these things were created during the war effort, and then when the war ended, there was no place for them to do it. So guys got together, big corporations, and they see that they can take ammonia nitrate, which is the same thing that they made bombs with, ammonia nitrate. It's a common agricultural chemical now, but they didn't have anything to do with that. So the corporations came up with a mindset and a way, because they knew that the plant would grow if they put this ammonium nitrate on there. It turned green and it would grow and it would be beautiful and everything would be great. So they built an industry around that to be able to try to keep their business going. So these nutrients that they mine, or either most of them come from petroleum distilleries, but they needed somewhere to get these and sell them. They wanted to sell them to keep their business going. So therefore we ended up with the whole, okay, we can take these monies and we can go to the colleges and get them to, tell everybody that this is the way to go, and it will work. But however, it's been proven that the nutrients and everything that's in the soil are not present in these plants that are grown in this way, because you don't have the whole system as a whole, the whole soil food web, to process all these nutrients and get them to all these plants. So I just wanted to be able to bring it to you today and let you know that there is a different way to do this. So we have to think of it when we go out there and we're planting our flowers or our shrubs or growing a garden for food or whatever. Either way, your plant is going to have a better color, it's going to have a better life, it's going to have a better all around if we are following the system that works, as opposed to the man-made system. So what we want to do is we want to try to take as least amount of action to be able to get our plant growing. So I want to open it up for questions. I don't have a whole lot other to show you or whatever, because of the I just didn't want to do a PowerPoint today. I wanted to kind of just open it up and just kind of see where we go. You've heard what I said there, that these nutrients that are in the soil are processed by this biology. I can go into another little thing about the ratio of fungi to bacteria. There's always a ratio of fungi to bacteria. If you think of a timeline or a line, linear, that on this side over here you have bare soil with no life in it whatsoever, and then on the other end of the scale we would have an old growth forest that was lush and green and had all these great plants growing in it. And I'm sure you've seen them, and if you haven't ever been to an old growth forest, but it's just there's just growth everywhere, and so there's no fertilizers being put out there, there's no pesticides being put there, there's no herbicides being put there, but yet the system works great and everything grows perfectly. So what we want to do is we want to try to get into that system rather than the other system. So this ratio of on the left would be the bacterial side of the ratio, and then you would have the fungal side on the other side, which would be the old growth forest. And you know that if you ever go around in the forest, you're going to see lots of mushrooms and you'll see the mycelium. If you pull back the leaf litter, you'll see these little white hairs, little filaments that you'll see running through these leaves and everything. Those are the actual mycelium that I'm talking about, speaking of, that are in the soil. So on the left side, I'm sure you probably all remember from the Master Gardener teaching, is that you start off with the grasses, the monocots, and they're the lowest over here on the left side, and they are more bacterially dominated. And then the forest is more fungal dominated. So what we have to do is try to figure out where our plant that we're trying to grow, whether it's a shrub or whether it's a flower, where does that flower fall in between that bare soil, which is all bacteria dominated, as opposed to the fungal dominated over on the right hand side. So as far as you go further to the right, then you end up with more fungal activity, and that's what makes that plant grow. So I try to, whenever I'm planting a tree, is make sure that I put that fungal inoculant in there already. So there are fungal inoculants that you can use to bacteria also that you can actually put in your plant instead of a fertilizer. What you want to do is jumpstart that biology. So once you jumpstart that biology, you don't need the fertilizer. You don't need these other things, you know, because your plant has what it needs to get going. So if anybody's got any, go ahead.
You said you inoculate.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Where do you get it?
I buy, you know, and there are ways to do it where you can actually, and I've done this before, where I actually go out into the forest and find the most wonderful tree that I can find, the most healthiest tree that I can find, peel back that leaf litter, and go down in there and get that bacteria and fungi that exist that already are acclimated to your area. They already are used to your weather, they're already used to what goes on around, and use that to mix into your potting soil that you're going to use or whatever medium that you're going to grow your plant in. Inoculate that with it and give it a jump start
to get that white stuff.
That's it, the little filaments that you're seeing in there. You'll see it, you know, if you,
I've seen it before,
you've seen
it. I didn't know what it was.
Mm-hmm. If you, a mushroom, if you think about it, a mushroom has no legs, so if it does its whole life and it is a decomposer, is what it is for this tree material, the lignin in the tree, it breaks down that lignin in the tree, the part that makes it the strong tree that it is. So this mushroom goes in there and it's programmed to break down this log. So once it breaks down the log, it runs out of food. How does it move on to some more food? Well, it pulls up a mushroom or pushes up a mushroom, and then it releases spores and they go through the air and then it goes to another log, and then the whole process takes over again. But these mycelium are actually the roots of the mushroom is what it is. And the mushroom is actually the fruiting body of the mycelium that are present. We walk around outside daily and we are walking and trampling over millions and millions and millions of fungi and bacteria every day, you know, that are integral parts of this whole world. And we were talking earlier and that there's more non-DNA, a non-human DNA in your body than there is human DNA. We have more bacteria and fungi in our body than we have human DNA, which is just off the chart. I mean, it's kind of hard to believe, but it's true that it's been proven that that's the way it is. And the same thing that's going on in the soil is the same thing that's going on in us, inside our gut. I mean, we're made from soil. We were made from soil, and naturally the same things that go on in the soil are what needs to go on inside our bodies, too. But, I take and I inoculate that. Every time I plant anything, I make sure that I put that inoculant in there, whether I go out and harvest it.
What's it called? If you wanted to order some somewhere, what would you look for?
Endo and ecto. Endo mycelium and ecto mycelium. Endo mycelium are generally used for a flowering plant or something like that. Ecto mycelium are used more for trees. But you always want to have that available whenever you're making a plant or planting a plant. And so that you get that bacteria started right off the bat and you get that whole system going, because we know that the system works. I mean, we see it out there, but then we know also that we can do a certain amount with the chemicals, but there's a point in time where you have to keep doing it. You have to go back, and it's more and more and more and more. It's part of the matrix that we're in with, you know, our agricultural way of doing things. So what I'm trying to do is promote and try to get everybody to see it from the natural point of view, and set aside, you know, the implications of being a naturalist or you know, a tree hugger or any kind of those kind of things. We just want to do a system that works, and the system that works is the one that he created to begin with. So why do we have to think that we are smarter than he was when he created this thing, that we would come out with something that we think is better and really is not. It's unsustainable, you know. Now, I say in my farm that my ideology says that I don't want to do anything to harm the processes that are going on in my soil. But however, my farm also has to be sustainable from the point of financially sustainable for it to keep going. If I don't intervene in some kind of a way, if I'm going to lose this crop or I'm going to lose this thing that's going to make some money for me to support my farm, if I don't intervene some kind of way, then I'm not going to be sustainable financially either, you know. So in that case, and in any other case, like if you're growing flowers or bushes or shrubs or whatever, there may be a point where you have to intervene in a way due to previous, you know, things that's happened before, you know, events that have taken place that have damaged the processes that are going on. So I will do something, but I have to do something that lines up with the natural things that are happening, as opposed to basically using a shotgun when you only needed a BB gun, right, you know, to get the job. Yeah.
Where does composting, because that's kind of doing something, but not, where does composting come in?
Composting is a process of taking organic material, plant matter, and breaking it down to a point to where you have done away with the pathogens and different types of things that are in there that you can use. So these bacteria and these fungi, they actually can more readily break down organic matter than they can for rock, naturally. You know, fungi can actually take rock and dissolve it, basically. They have the acids in their bodies that can actually take those nutrients out of that rock and make it available to that plant. But however, if you have compost, it doesn't have to go that far. So you realize a whole lot faster event than you would if you were just trying to do it from rock. So
that would give your soil a jump start?
It would.
Okay,
yes.
So
on my farm, personally, we don't use any animal manures at all. So we use plant matter and compost, because each of those plants, if they've been grown, they have already extracted those nutrients and they are in that plant. And then when it starts breaking down, those nutrients are released to these bacteria and fungi, you know, and then they take them to the plant. So one of the best things you could do is compost.
Best thing?
Not fertilizer, but actually compost. So the compost is not a fertilizer, it's actually an inoculant. So those bacteria and fungi are actually in that compost also. So those are some of the natural processes. The heat that builds up in compost is actually the heat coming from the bacteria breaking down these nutrients, because they're reproducing. So naturally, during reproduction, heat happens, right? So that's what happens. So the heat is from that actual process that's had taken place with this bacteria and fungi breaking down these minerals that are inside those organic matter. So generally, I say, and this is just me, I say use compost over anything, and good compost. You want to have a compost that's gone through a heat. It has to be up to 160 degrees for I think it's like 2 days, you know, that you got to be there about 24-48 hours at that temperature to make sure no pathogens are in there. But the thing about it is, if you don't use an animal manure, you're not bringing those pathogens into your compost. So you want to make sure you have good compost, and then if you don't need the manure, why even put it in there? You know, you don't really need it, because all the nutrients are already in that compost. And so we just need to get them into a bioavailable form for the plant through the biology. That's the way it works. So if you have if you have good compost, you don't need fertilizer because the compost contains the nutrients that's in there. So you just need a way to get it to the plant. And the way to get it to the plant is through the biology. So anything we can do to not harm that biology, that's the key. So when we're thinking and we're contemplating doing something like adding a fertilizer or adding something to our potting mix or whatever, we always want to think about, okay, how is this going to affect that biology that's going on in the soil? And that soil biology is going to be the key to everything that we grow. I mean, that's just the way it works. That's the way his plan is, and that's we can't go against it. Or we can, but it doesn't work.
I have a situation at home if you can help me with. I have a, it's in my front yard, and I have a bed like on either side of the wall. And there's this spot on either side, and it's the same spot on both sides. Like nothing, everything I plant there dies. Now, on the left side, it's still living, but it's not looking too bright.
Mm-hmm.
But finally, on the other side, I just gave up and put a statue there.
Well, that is an option.
Yes, it is.
Well, I tell you, what happens a lot of times is compaction, especially around the edge of a house. Because think about it, when they built the house, the first thing they did and when they came in there, they just wiped everything off and packed it down with heavy equipment and all this kind of stuff. And then we come back around the base of our house, and then we try to make a flower bed. And we have extremely compacted soil around the edge of a house. So the first thing you want to do is loosen that soil up, because that's one of the first things that, or one of the worst things that can happen is to have a compaction layer. And what happens when water comes down, it goes down through the soil and hits that compaction layer and goes sideways. And so it moves away from whatever's right there, and it moves away from it, and it's going downhill wherever it's going to go. But it's due to a compaction layer and that the water won't actually go through. And you think about it too. If you have a compaction layer, one of the main things that you need is aeration in your soil for the oxygen, because these bacteria and fungi, they need oxygen to live. And so if you have an anaerobic means absence of oxygen. So if you have an anaerobic situation, you have no oxygen, you have no bacteria, you have no fungi, you have none of that. You know, and what?
It stinks when
it goes. It stinks, that's right, it stinks, because what's happening, you have bacteria, but you have bad bacteria. And what the bad bacteria gives off are gases like, you know, sulfur, you get that sulfur smell, you get that acrid, you know, smell, yep.
Great. Okay, let's say the soil's impacted and it's hard.
Mm-hmm.
How far down do we need to dig in order to loosen that soil
there,
up?
There is a probe, and I think probably the Extension Service has one. Most of them do. It's called a soil compaction meter, and it measures hydraulically, or either a spring, that whenever you mash that down in there, that how many pounds per square inch it's taken to put this probe down into the ground. So as you put the probe down in there, you'll usually see that the first 6 or 8 inches are not bad. But then when you get to that next point, it just like stops, and it takes a lot of pressure to go through it. And then once you go through that layer, then it'll get easy again. And usually you'll have about that much that'll be fluffy soil, you know, and then you'll have another 8-10 inches, maybe even a foot or more, that'll be really compacted. And then below that, it's like native soil then. You know, it's not been damaged or anything. It's not been compacted.
Yeah,
so
I have something similar to
it. It could be as much as 18 inches,
yeah.
You know, or it could be just a few inches. Now, a lot of our a lot of our houses are built on former farmland. And so they'll take and make a subdivision in an old peanut field or something, you know. And you'll have this compaction layer will be there from the farming practice, because what happens is as the plow goes through the soil, then it compacts the soil, and they can only go down so far, but they cause the compaction to be, the compaction layer will always be just below the reach of the plow blade. You know, it'll be just beyond that. So they're constantly trying. And if you see now, you see a lot of farmers, they're not doing the old bottom plow method where they're taking the soil and throwing it over on top. What they're actually doing is leaving that layer of mulch, basically the cover crop that they've grown. They come back in and push that cover crop over and then plant right in the cover crop, because the earth does not like to be uncovered. The earth wants to be covered. Mother Earth does not like to be naked. So she's always wanting to grow something on that soil to protect it, because it needs that protection. That's why you always want to use mulch or something like that. If your tolerance level for grass and weeds is high, then you can stand some. But if your tolerance level is not and you want to have a pretty pristine garden, then you need to compost, you need to mulch on it to keep that soil covered. And now think about it too, whenever you do that mulching, you're actually causing and promoting a more fungally dominated environment, especially if you have like box shrubs or something like that, that's a woody shrubbery kind of a thing around the house or whatever, then you're setting up the conditions to have a higher fungal amount in the soil there, which is a good thing for those type of plants. If you think about it, you know, from the left being the bacterially dominated, as opposed to on the right hand, the old growth forest would be extremely fungal dominated. You may have one part per million over here on the left of fungi, but you might have a million to one in a forest of fungi to bacteria. So you have a lot more fungi in a forest than you do bacteria. And then totally opposite on the other side. But depending on what you're trying to grow is how much of that you want to do, you know, where you want to try to be at, you know. So there's an art to figuring out, what is this plant like, you know. We never consider that. Most of the time we put a plant wherever we want to. You know, we want the plant there, and we want it to do well there, and we expect it to, you know, but really, we're picking the wrong plant in a lot of cases, you know, for that particular instance in that particular location. But 9 times out of 10, to answer your question, it's compaction around the house. You know, now, if you're out in the field or something, that might be a different story out there.
Meteorite fell.
What?
A meteorite fell.
A meteorite fell and compacted it. But yeah, that's why I would say that the majority of it is compaction. That's what I see in a lot of cases. I've learned a lot about this lately because of working for a nonprofit out of Montgomery. We're going to talk to new and beginning farmers, and this is one of the biggest things, is trying to help them and understand this and trying to get them to be able to not use all these chemicals and everything that costs lots of money, and makes it more profitable for them and more sustainable for their farm to be able to start off like this, as opposed to starting off buying all this big heavy equipment, doing all these interventions and with pesticides, herbicides, or whatever it is they need. You know, it's a lot cheaper to get started if you don't have to buy all that stuff, you know. But go ahead.
I have the bad nematodes. Mm-hmm. You have any suggestions?
The answer to pretty much everything is more biology, because think about it. The nematode is not eating the plant. It's not eating the plant. It's affecting the plant, but it's not eating the plant. That nematode is part of a system where the smallest item, like say a bacteria or whatever, an amoeba, or one cell or whatever, they are there and they are being ate by next order of in the line of progression of the soil food web. That next one gets eaten by the smaller, the bigger one eats the smaller one and then defecates, and then that becomes part of our soil, and then something else eats that next one up, and it just goes right on, you know, as they go up, you know. You have these different orders of animals that are going to prey on the other animals. So there are nematodes that actually feed on other nematodes, but that you have to have that other biology that's lower to get to that point. In other words, you've got to have the complete system to get there. Compost would be a good thing. Yeah, mix some compost with it. And if you had a compaction, if you take, like, let's just say you had some kind of a metal rod of some kind, you can just take it and push it down into the soil and see where that hard place is. And if there's a hard place there, you'll get to it and it'll stop. You won't be able to go any further. So the only thing you can basically do is try to get air and oxygen and water down through that compaction layer so that that bacteria and fungi, the biology, can get there again, because they can't even make it to there, because it's their job to take care of that, and they're programmed to do that, and they will do that if they have the opportunity. But if we go in and we put a fertilizer salt there, we've just killed our biology that we had, you know. So we want to try to not do any of that kind of stuff if we can, and just try to get that oxygen and that water back down into that area. And I just use a pitchfork. You know, I just take a good, sturdy, strong pitchfork, or they have heavier duty things, but just to put that down in the soil and not dig in the soil, but just punching a hole in it, because that gives a pathway for that air and that water to get down into that soil. And so once that happens, then you get the biology started down there, because that's one of the first things they have to have, just like all of us. We have to have air, we have to have water. You know, the food is there. They just need air and water to get to that point. And then you'll find that instead of your plant having a root that goes down 6 or 8 inches and it hits a concrete block, you know, so to speak, and it can't go any further. And you'll see that as that softens up, you'll get the longer roots, and the roots go down longer, which helps you also with your water consumption. You won't have near as much water consumption if you have the roots that are going further down. And a plant, a normal grass, it should have a root probably 5 or 6 feet deep. You know, it should. You know, it should go that deep. But it doesn't, because the majority of the time, like I say, we're putting it around the house or whatever, and it's completely compacted and it can't do it. You know, and we have to keep watering, and we have to keep fertilizing, you know, and doing all these things, which if we could get the biology started, we wouldn't have to do all that, you know. So that's what I've seen is compaction as being one of the biggest, you know, detriments to growing around the house. Yes, ma'am.
The inoculant, do you use it as a powder, or do you have to dissolve and use it as a liquid?
It's a powder, yeah. It's basically there in a dormant state, you know, and then whenever you mix the water in with it, then they wake up again. You know, they get water and they get air. Guess what? They start reproducing. That's what they need. Yes, ma'am.
You said you don't use animal waste.
Right, I don't use any animal manures. Yeah.
I've got an endless supply of donkey poop.
Well, I'll say, I don't say that you don't need to use animal manures. The reason why on my farm that we don't use animal manures is because we don't want the possibility of bringing in some pathogen from somewhere else, or in the case of an animal, and it having been given some kind of a like say ivermectin or something like that for a worm or something like that, because that's going to affect my biology. And the half-life on a lot of that stuff is, you know, months, several months, maybe even a year, you know, before they get to the level where they're not going to damage anything when you use it. So that's just personally why we don't do it on our farm, just because we wanted to have the least risk of anything like that happening. I mean, you see it on the news all the time, you know, about salmonella and E. coli and all these things. They're from animals. They have to live in warm-blooded animals. They don't live in anything else, you know. So you have to have the presence of animals somewhere for that to happen, you know. And generally it's from manures, you know, that haven't been processed properly. And then you have it contaminated on somebody's hands or whatever, and then they move it into the stream of the vegetables some kind of way, you know, it gets in there. So basically that's why we don't use the animal manures. But it's not a bad thing. You know, like on a rose garden or whatever, you know, it wouldn't be a problem, but I would just make sure it was good composted manure, not fresh, you know.
How would you compost it good?
Well, you get into a situation where you can actually mix the two amounts of, like, take your manure, and it's like party food for the bacteria. It's like party food. So you would want to take and look at your carbon and nitrogen ratios of material that you put in there, because you want to kind of keep around 30-1 carbon to nitrogen. So that would mean like one part manure as opposed to 20 or 30 parts of other materials. So you don't need much of the party food, because you're going to really kick them up, and then once you kick them up to that heat level, then you also are, if it goes too hot, then it gets anaerobic, and then you're backing up again. You know, you absence of oxygen, bacteria die, fungi die, and then you have putrefied organic matter is what you have. It has no life, and the life is in that bacteria and fungi. The life is in the soil, you know. So if it has that bacteria and fungi in there, then, you know, you're going to do a lot better, you know. So I don't say that nobody use manure, but that's just what we do on raising vegetables, and we have products that are eaten raw, you know. So it's very important to us, you know, to make sure that we don't have any kind of contamination of any kind, you know. So if we can mitigate that and make that risk lower by not using that fertilizer, I don't have to, then I don't, you know. Now, a bird fertilizer doesn't have that. Now, a bird, like a chicken or whatever, can have a salmonella, you know, in it, but E. coli doesn't grow on, you know, a chicken manure. You know.
And you would compost it the same way.
Right, you can do the same thing. Yeah, you don't want to use any compost that has our we use the term loosely when we say compost, because technically it has to go through that heat, you know, and that heat process for all these pathogens to be broken down and make them where they won't harm us, you know, or anything else for that matter. So, but to answer your question about the compost, you would just need to pay attention to your carbon materials and your nitrogen materials that you're putting in there. And there's all kinds of stuff on the internet about making compost, you know, and you can do it all kinds of different ways. But and what I found in most people, when they think about compost, really, they're not talking about compost. They're talking about putrefied organic matter, you know, that's dead. You know, it's anaerobic, it smells. A good compost should be a light brown, about the color of like 80% dark chocolate. You know how that color is kind of a toffee color? It should be about that. You know, it shouldn't be black. Everybody thinks, oh, black soil's the best, but no. Most of the time, black soil means it's dead. You know, there's no life in it. You know, so you want to have that life kickstarted right when you plant your plant. Now, I buy this mycorrhizal material from a guy who produces it in North Carolina that has a mushroom farm. It's basically where it comes from. He takes it and dries it and then puts it in a granulated form. And then basically what we do is take a pistol and mortar or something like that and just crush it up. Because you don't need that much. Like whenever I plant a plant, like say if I'm going to put a plant in a 4-inch pot, I will just have a very slight pinch, because all I'm doing is just inoculating. Because once they get there and they see all this food, this organic material in there, they're going to go crazy. They're going to start reproducing, you know, because that's what they do. So it doesn't take much. And the same way with the compost. If you're making compost, you go ahead and put your inoculant in there, in your compost, so you kick it up and you've got the good guys in there, and you're not worried about the bad guys, you know, because the guys who are there first usually get, you know, the choice ground, and they'll proceed on from there, and they'll keep the bad guys out. Same way with pathogens on leaves and stuff like that, you know, that if you have good bacteria, good fungi in your soil and on your leaves and in your plant, then the pathogens from the like a fungal pathogen that would come up, let's just say like powdery mildew. So powdery mildew only comes under certain conditions. When the certain conditions are right, then that powdery mildew will start to flourish. Well, if you have the good guys there, and they're, you know, doing their thing, they'll kick the powdery mildew out. They won't let them, there won't be a receptor site that's available. So when that fungal spore comes along, he's got nowhere to hang on to, because everybody's already took all the places where you hang on to on the plant, because there are receptors for that, you know, where that fungal spore will attach itself to that plant and start growing. So if all the old, you know, it's a different way to think about it, I'll tell you that.
If you had several cubic feet of black, useless donkey poop that has been there a while, it's got earthworms in it, down in the bottom.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But it's getting hard now at the top.
Well, I would mix it with straw.
Well, I've got a huge natural area where we hauled in dump truck loads of wood chips.
Uh-huh.
And it's got all kinds of mushrooms growing up that come up.
The fungal,
Would you take that black dirt and dump it into that?
You could do that. You got to think about, too, that you want to try to keep that ratio, depending on what you're going to try to grow there, that you would want to use, if it was a woody, perennial bush type of a plant that you were trying to grow, that would be more on the fungal side. So you would use more chips for that. But if it wasn't, then you wouldn't need as many chips. You'd want more like straw and things like that. You know, so more of a grass, a monocot from, you know, further to the left, you know, in the line, if you think of it that way, you know. So it depends on what you're trying to grow. So if you were trying to mix this up to make it for a box shrub, you'd want more chips in it. But if you were trying to grow a flower or a vegetable, you'd want a little bit less chips. You'd want to be a little bit more to the left side, to the more the bacterial side, you know.
What if you were growing long grass?
Long grass will be that grass. It'll be more bacterial.
Can I just dump that black side? I've got a spot in my yard. last year it had some yellow things that looked like you just sprayed some yellow stuff in the grass dot. Well, this year the weeds all came in and the yellow's bigger and the grass was frozen.
Well, you think of it like this too, that weed has a purpose. And that weed, you can read the weeds in a yard, and you can see what nutrients are lacking in that, or if there's compaction there. If you see something like bull thistle or dandelions or you know, anything with a great big taproot that goes down, think about it. What is it trying to do? That plant comes up, it grows, it puts those roots down, and these are really strong plants and can really push through that hard pan there. So it comes up, it does its thing, it makes out seeds and everything, and it dies. It's not a perennial, it's an annual plant. So naturally, it dies, then what's it left in the ground? It's left a hole. It's left an avenue. It's left a highway down into the ground to get that water and that air down in there, like I was talking about a while ago. So these big tap-rooted plants that are weeds are actually there to bust up that compaction, open it up. You know.
So if I take a pitchfork and break up that compaction,
that's
and
right,
put my donkey stuff on top,
you'd probably be all right. Mix a little straw in there with it, and you'd probably be all right. You know, it's going to take a little while for it to break down.
Grow some daikon radishes the first year.
There you go. I mean, I use daikon radishes a lot.
What is
daikon radish? It's a radish with a, it makes a great big, I've seen them as big as that, you know, and they go deep too. And so they just really open it up.
Okay, okay.
So, you know, that's another thing. You see a lot of farmers now are planting their cover crops, all have radishes in them. You'll see them out there. You can look out there and spot, there's a radish out there, you know. That, usually hairy vetch and Daffron radish and rye, winter rye, and several others like that, that they're trying to give it a rounded thing. You use legumes will release nitrogen into the soil. They're nitrogen fixing plants due to the bacteria that they associate with.
So how far will the earthworms go? I mean, will they get through this hard pan or not?
Earthworms won't really do it. They can't, they got to have oxygen too, because they're okay, not just eating, you know, they're eating other animals too. So and if those animals are not there, then they're not going to be there either.
So they'll go down as far as there's air for them to breathe.
Right, and okay. And there's food for them to eat, you know. So really, you know, we think of earthworms eating the material, but they're not. They're eating the bacteria and fungi that eat the material.
They just don't eat dirt.
That's right, yeah. They don't eat the dirt, but they poop out the fertilizer, you know, through the process of the bacteria and fungi. Anybody else got anything? Well, maybe this has helped you a little bit to try to think about this thing a little different than what you thought about it before. You know, so you're not going to learn all this in one day. You know, it's going to take a gradual thinking about and contemplating what you're trying to do with this plan, you know, and what's the requirements for that plan.
So,
but the answer to everything is soil biology. That's the bottom line. If you got soil biology, everything else will take care of itself.
Yeah, yeah.
It will.
That makes sense.
Well, if there's no other questions, consider it over. I sell them, actually.
Oh,
yeah, so I buy them in the big